Good morning. As an AP Physics reader, I recently looked over several thousand free body diagrams from students from everywhere. I think we need to talk about how to draw free body diagrams for the AP Physics exams.
Flippin' physics!
To be clear, I already have so many videos about various kinds of forces, what directions they should be in, and which forces to put in free body diagrams. So, watch those videos if you need help learning what the direction of the force normal is, or if the component of the force of gravity parallel is up or down the incline, or...
Down! The force of gravity parallel is always down the incline!
Right, but that's not what this video is about.
Actually, we never break forces into components in free body diagrams, which are answers on AP Physics exams, right?
Okay, yeah, that is a good point.
Yes, but... Again, this video is simply about how to correctly draw forces in free body diagrams on AP Physics exams. Because, trust me, we need to go over this.
We trust you.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, here we go. Since the update to all the AP Physics exams for 2025, every free body diagram you will be asked to draw will be drawn in the free response booklet and will be drawn on a figure which looks something like this. There is a central dot, which represents the center of mass of the object or system, and a grid for aiding in drawing the free body diagram. Okay, class. The tail of every force vector arrow you draw on a free body diagram starts where?
On the center of mass.
Correct. For example, you can see this free body diagram has all three force vector arrows starting at the central dot, which represents the center of mass of the object or system, and pointing away from that center of mass.
But what if there are two forces that act in the same direction?
Then you just draw the two vectors parallel to one another, like this.
Correct. And if you are having trouble fitting the tails of all your forces on the center of mass dot, you can always increase the size of that dot. Do not, for example, draw your force vectors as curved lines to make them all start at the center of mass dot.
Oh, right. Yeah, the force vectors in free body diagrams are always straight lines and never curved lines.
Absolutely. And please, do not draw one force vector on the end of another force vector like this.
Oh, and then the force vectors are outside of the provided grid. That is not good, right?
Correct. Also, please do not draw your force vectors outside of the provided grid, but do use most of the grid. In other words, please do not draw very small force vectors.
People did not really draw free body diagrams like that, did they?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, okay. Label all of the force vectors in your free body diagrams. I prefer F with an uppercase N subscript for force normal, F with a lowercase g subscript for force of gravity, F with a lowercase s, F for force of static friction, F with an uppercase T for force of tension, and so forth. However, as long as it is clear what you mean, you should be fine. For example, for normal force, you could also just write capital N, or F with a lowercase n subscript, or even the words normal force. For force of gravity, you could also write F with a subscript of GRAV, or capital W, or M times G, the words gravitational force, or the word weight. However, I will point out that it would not be acceptable for the force of gravity to just write a lowercase g or an uppercase g.
Hold up. Why not?
Because lowercase g or uppercase g just means gravity.
And the term gravity is not clear enough on an AP Physics exam.
You have to identify it as the force of gravity, not just gravity.
Because there is also the acceleration due to gravity, gravitational field strength, gravitational potential energy.
Oh.
Right. Please never use the term gravity by itself on an AP Physics exam. You have to clarify. Is it the force of gravity? Is it the acceleration due to gravity? And so on.
And we need to remember that the only vectors we should draw in free body diagrams are force vectors. For example, we should never put displacement, velocity, acceleration, momentum, impulse, and other vectors like that in free body diagrams. Only force vectors. Right, Mr. P?
Absolutely, Bobby.
And please, write legibly. We have to be able to read what you wrote. That is just reality. We try really hard to read what you wrote. However, you also have to do your best to write so we can read what you wrote. Maybe your handwritten uppercase N and uppercase W look identical. If that is the case, then you should write out the words force normal and weight instead, please.
Mr. P?
Yes, Billy?
Do you want me to mention that this lesson is a free portion of your AP Physics 1 Ultimate Exam Slayer, which is packed with in-depth videos on all four types of free response questions, detailed breakdowns of every category of multiple choice, and battle-tested test-taking strategies just like the ones you see in this very video? But wait, there's more? You'll get not one, but two full-length practice exams, each powered by our AP Exam Simulator, which is carefully crafted to mirror the real digital AP exam experience. This simulator is not created or endorsed by the College Board or Blue Book. It is just made to help you dominate the exam. Do you want me to say that?
No, thanks. I'm good.
Yeah, no need.
Oh, okay.
Now, let's talk about the grid for a moment. The grid is there to help you be able to show the relative magnitudes of your force vectors. For example, you can see in this free body diagram, the force normal and force of gravity are both 5 grid spaces in length, and therefore the force normal and force of gravity are equal in magnitude. You can also see that the force of kinetic friction is 3 grid spaces in length. However, the force applied is 4 grid spaces in length. Therefore, the force of kinetic friction has a smaller magnitude than the force applied. That is why the grid is there. I suggest that you always have at least 1 grid length difference between 2 force vectors when you are trying to show they are different.
Really?
Yes, really. I mean it. It is so easy to do. Just have at least 1 grid length difference between any 2 force vector arrows that have different magnitudes.
It is not that difficult.
Yeah. Okay. Fine.
Now, some more subtle things. Be careful of when and where you are drawing your free body diagrams for. As a hypothetical example, a ball may be rolling down an incline, rolling along a level table, and then flying off the table into the air. And you are asked to draw a free body diagram of all the forces acting on the ball after it has left the table. I would probably see a not insignificant number of students who would draw the free body diagram for when the ball was still on the table or on the incline. That is not what the question is asking, so please read carefully. Okay, another mistake I saw. When you are drawing a free body diagram, it is of all the forces acting on the object. All the forces acting on the object, not just the ones that do not cancel out. For example, if we have a disc sliding to the right on a table and slowing down, the forces in the free body diagram are the upward force normal, the downward force of gravity, and the leftward force of kinetic friction. For some reason, I had an inordinately large number of students who only drew the force of kinetic friction in the free body diagram. In fact, many of these students were able to correctly complete the rest of the free response question. However, they lost 2 out of 10 points for the free response question because they were unable to draw the free body diagram correctly.
It'll be okay, Mr. P.
Yeah, we will listen to you. Yeah, we will.
I know. It just makes me sad. I wish more people would learn from my videos and not only understand more physics, but be better able to demonstrate their understanding of that physics to other people and on exams. I'm doing my best here.
We know.
Yeah, we hear you.
Thanks. And lastly, once you draw your free body diagram answer, leave it alone. Later in the problem, if you need to resolve forces into components, draw an entirely new working free body diagram. Please. Actually, I'm sorry, there is one more thing.
Of course there is.
Please draw the arrowheads of the force vectors directly on the end of the line for the vector. I saw too many force vector arrowheads which were drawn like the one for this force normal vector. You can see the length of the lines for the force of gravity and force normal vectors are the same. However, because the arrowhead for the force normal was not drawn on the line, as a reader trying to assess if those force vectors are the same length, it's honestly, it's just difficult to know and figure out. So please draw all of your arrowheads on the end of the line for the force vector, like you see on the force of gravity.
Actually, yeah, that is helpful.
Yeah.
Thanks.
You are welcome. Well, I think that is all I have to say right now about drawing free body diagrams. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.